Ready, everybody ready? Okay, I'm going to go ahead then and call the January 6, 2020 Public Works Committee meeting to order. We'll start with roll call, please.
Mr. Katura?
Here.
Mrs. Meany?
Here.
Mr. Schmitz?
Here.
Okay, changes to the agenda. We're just going to move up item 6 and 7. They will go first, just out of courtesy to the folks that are here from Burgess and Nyepel. Okay, so then we have a set of minutes we need to get approved.
I'll make a motion to approve the minutes of December 4th, 2019.
Second.
Okay, I have a motion and a second. Roll call, please.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Schmitz?
Yes.
Okay, under pending, we have nothing. Under new, like I say, we're going to move up, so we'll do item 6, which is professional services for the water reclamation facility concrete repair project. Paul?
Good evening.
Good evening.
Happy New Year to everybody.
Happy New Year.
Okay, as you're aware, we're doing the concrete repair program down at the plant, and what this entails is we have various areas throughout the plant that we deem needs to be repaired. We have some floors in our solids building, a floor and walkway in our tertiary building. We have a bunch of areas throughout the outside of the plant, our trickling towers, windows, things of that nature that need to be have the concrete replaced. We contracted with BNN to come in and do the design services for this work. Part of that work was to hire a testing company to come in, evaluate the concrete before the design was done. We brought the testing company in, had this all paid for through our city PO, and during the course of that project, or during this testing, they found out that there's some additional work that's going to need to be done. Specifically, some of the areas is over the storage tanks, the sludge storage tanks, and where the electrical transformer is for the power coming into the solids building. So representatives from BNN are here tonight to kind of explain why the additional costs. The additional costs are going to be approximately $38,100, I believe.
138.
Number 6. Yeah,
so it'd be 138, and then.
The total would be $138,100, and it was about $38,000. Was that correct? $34,950. I'm sorry. I should have put my glasses on. So to that, I will bring up the representatives. We have Tim Antos, Chris, Keith Alstead, and Joe Stadlick from BNN. You guys want to come up?
Good evening, gentlemen.
Are you guys able to get this feed on the laptop?
Yes.
Do you have it? Okay, great. So thank you for having us here tonight and giving us this time. As Paul said, this is work that was identified after our initial contract, which was executed in October of last year. It was brought to our attention in communications with the city in March of 2019 when they were doing inspection of their sludge tanks, that these areas had additional work that needed to be addressed also. The areas were unknown prior to simply because they are closed, confined spaces that are typically not gone into. So Paul and John had asked if we would come and just show you some of the pictures of what is going on, some of the repairs from the original scope and also from these sludge tanks. So I'm going to turn it over to Keith at this time to just run through the PowerPoint real quick.
Okay. So this first picture right here is just kind of showing you what the starting point was for this project. This was actually done previous. There was a report by Arcadis where they also did some concrete testing to figure out what the issues they were having in this floor was. This is one of the problem areas that was found. It's over the front sludge tanks, numbers 1, 2, and 3. As you can see, there's probably about 2 to 4 inches of concrete that was delaminated, which means it was popping up off, and they cleared it out so you could see the reinforcing steel there. So that was all found by Arcadis and then repaired as to Arcadis's specifications. This is another picture just kind of showing you what we walked into during our inspection. So you can kind of see all those repairs were made, but as we visually inspected it and as we sounded the floor, we found problem areas. Just another general picture to show you kind of what's going on in the area. This is of electrical equipment that is sitting on top of those sludge tanks. Another area you can kind of see, this is that same area that was shown in that first image. There's still some repair that was visible there, but that repair is already coming up, is already damaged. So this is again all visible in our inspection. Now this is a two-story building. The images that I was showing you previously were of the first floor where you walk in. This is an image of the underside when you walk in through the basement, walk down the stairs. So this is a typical image of the underside of the slab. And after visual inspection and the city provided some scaffolding and ladders so we could get up and actually sound the roof, we didn't find heavy amounts of damage or really any cracking there. There was one concentrated area of cracking, but nothing too severe, something that could be easily repaired. Just more pictures. Again, another area, but this one kind of goes to show you the complexity of how many things are hanging from this slab. This is a good image showing you the outside of the tanks. These tanks span inside and outside. They hold two transformers that house the power for this, and I believe further on in the plant. Is that correct?
Well, it's a daisy chain, more or less, so it jumps from those transformers to other areas of the plant.
Okay, thank you.
So you got incoming and outgoing power.
Yeah. Okay. These tanks also support the exterior wall that you see there. So this is an image shown of sludge tank number two. So if I go back and show the dates, we inspected this in January of 2019. So these images of the inside of those sludge tanks that I just showed the picture of was given to us by Paul on the March 3rd after they were able to get inside of those tanks, clean them out, and inspect them. And as Tim mentioned, that is a confined space. We were not able to actually access this when we were doing our investigation because of that. So what you see there is a damaged underside, which if you recall from the first couple images, the top side is damaged, the underside is now damaged as well. The important thing there is we weren't able to see the damage on the underside because we didn't have access to those tanks. This image, you can see there's ladder entry. We'd have to have gas equipment and everything to monitor breathing air. This is a image of the walkway through the central part of the solids handling facility. You can see that the city had placed down a steel plate to kind of protect where some spalls were. This area is wanting to be used by a forklift. You can see some more of the deterioration there. That is over sludge tank number four, which is actually further into the building. It was requested that we take a look inside of sludge tank number four and number five, which were not being used during that time. So after the city had cleaned out one, two, and three, we were able to come back and get inside tank number four and number five and take a look at those. So you can see there is some damage to the roof here as well, but it's more localized. It's minimal. It's a little bit easier to handle. It's another good picture for you. This is number five. There really wasn't any damage reported by the city, who also got into these two tanks as well. And that is what I have for you.
Okay, Paul.
So as Keith had mentioned, that those areas, can you go back to that area with the plate going over that, where we run the tow motor?
Yeah.
Isn't that?
Yeah.
That one, Paul.
Yeah. So this area here, we run the tow motor in probably at least once or twice through the month, and we carry polymer totes through there. When we found out how bad that underside of that storage tank was, we figured we needed to do something on top of it so we could continue to run that tow motor in and out of there. So. Obviously, our concern is that the whole floor was going to need to be replaced in this area. So, you know, it's something we definitely have to do. There's no two ways about it.
They mentioned, Paul, and I don't know if you, that Arcadia did do some of this work, and so what then you found that the work they did wasn't...
What happened was, is Arcadis, during the preliminary treatment improvement project, when they were on site, we had one of their... concrete engineers mm-hmm. come out and look at that. Mm-hmm. Other structural engineers. He did a sample over one of the storage tanks and collected that information. And basically what that test was is just to see what the cause of the delamination was.
Okay.
And that was due to chlorides, which I believe is the same thing that BNN found as well. So to see what was causing the damage. Was it hydrogen sulfide from the sludge storage tanks, you know, was it something else, chemicals that we're using in the building? But it seems like it was just poor concrete that was put in initially.
Okay. So basically you guys are going to go in, let us know what exactly
is needed. Do you want to maybe talk about, just like you had mentioned before, we're not doing improvements to all the sludge tanks, correct?
Right. Now, right, just yeah. I can go over some of the... So there are differing levels of damage, like I showed you. So this is the top of sludge tank number four. Number five, there wasn't found to be any real damage there, so we don't look to do anything more there than resurface the floor. It's an epoxy coated, so we'll probably tear that up, replace that. Number four is this damaged area on the underside, and then that damaged area by the top plates. So we'll probably look to cut out a piece of that while it is still supported by the walls of that sludge tank, and then replace a piece of that. Numbers 1, 2, and 3, the ones that are more heavily damaged, those are a little bit trickier. Probably look to replace the full tops of those. In doing that, we will have to support the exterior wall that's there and have to support those transformers, and probably do that in phases so we can use one transformer at a time. And then I don't know if isolation is possible between the tanks, but we'll have to look at using the gates that are in those tanks as well, possibly replacing those.
Yeah, those are also on the scope, is to replace the slide gates between the tanks.
Correct.
And Paul, this is obviously something, I know you have great people down there, but this is something that you would need outside. Like,
yes. And also, we didn't mention over the course of this presentation that there were some other things that we came up with. As Tim had mentioned, the slide gates will need to be replaced as part of, during this work inside the storage tanks, we're going to replace those slide gates and the mounting structures on the wall. A new floor drain in the truck bay of the solids building. And there was some work that needed to be done to the EQ pinch valve that we noticed after the fact that we figured as long as we are coming here requesting some additional engineering services that we would add that to the course of the project.
Okay. Anybody else have any questions? Mark, Bob? No? Is there okay? Okay, gentlemen. Well, good luck with that.
Thank you.
Thank you. It'll be
and what's the time frame? I mean, once you guys say this is what needs to be done, do you have any idea how long it will take a company or Paul, do you, to fix what needs to be fixed?
Well, we're already, you know, the original contract was executed end of last year, right. And Keith is already through a good portion of that mm-hmm. design, but that is looking at all the different buildings in the plant. So he's about halfway through that, and now we've got this additional piece, right. Okay. Which arguably is one of the more complex because of the load-bearing wall and the transformer. There's a lot of phasing that needs to go into that. So, okay. I mean, we're probably still a good couple, you know, probably maybe 2-3 months out from getting okay. that all set okay. in terms of the design.
Okay. Okay.
So moving along.
Okay. But you would have no idea once, like I say, then we would pick a company.
Oh, construction duration you're
yes.
talking?
Yes.
What were we looking at? That? I think we're looking around 6 months
six
or
months.
So.
6 months.
Yeah, we're looking at roughly 6 months is what we were thinking.
Okay. Well, no, obviously something that we need to take care of.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, the sooner the better, obviously. Sure. We always try to get these jobs bid early mm-hmm. To get going on right. the project and hopefully get a better price. So I'll be okay. pushing these guys to try to get this done as soon as we can so we can get a bid
great.
As soon as possible.
Okay.
And something else I just wanted to point out is that, you know, the original scope of this design was $99,500. So this additional work is, again, as we mentioned before, $34,950.
Okay. Okay, great. Well, thank you very much, gentlemen. Appreciate you coming and
appreciate your time. Yeah, thanks for your time.
An important part of our infrastructure here in the city, so we want to make sure it stays maintained. Appreciate your expertise.
Thank you.
Well, how about if we make motions on these two, since they're fresh in our heads, if that's okay mm-hmm. with you gentlemen. So I'll entertain a motion then for item sure. six.
I'd like to make a motion to prepare legislation that authorizes the approval of the proposal that was attached to Paul Solonik's memo to the Public Works Committee regarding bidding and construction administration for the water reclamation facility concrete repair program or repair project. And this is as part of our general engineering design services contract. This is from Burgess and Nyepel in the amount of $138,100.
No, I didn't talk about that one yet. That's
oh,
if you want to, I would. That's also being used. To keep things straight, let's go ahead and if you guys want to approve number seven.
Oh, okay. Sorry.
Which seven was the additional engineering for the design
gotcha.
Services?
Okay.
Why don't we start over then?
But you did such a good motion.
All right. So, in response to Director Solonik's January 2nd, 2020 memo to the Public Works Committee regarding the water reclamation facility concrete repair project additional engineering design services. I'd like to make a motion to amend ordinance 2018-207 and in the amount not to exceed $34,950 with Burgess and Nyepel as part of our general engineering design services contract. Now, you don't need these under emergency?
And under emergency.
Yes,
under
I did.
Okay.
And yeah, it's under emergency.
Okay. So okay, I have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Mr. Katera?
Yes.
Mrs. Meade?
Yes.
Mr. Shivitz?
Yes.
Okay. So you want to do six then? Talk about six a little bit.
Want to do six while they're here?
Yeah. We'll finish up, Paul.
Are you done with this?
Thank you.
your minutes to check so you can do that on your own.
Someone set me up.
Oops, sorry. Excuse me. Okay. On to number six. Okay, so with this whole project going on, we started thinking about who's going to be running the construction administration of this project. Obviously, our engineering department is kind of inundated with all the work that they have going on. So we thought it was important that since Burgess and Nyepel is doing this, that we hire them to do the construction administration. The construction administration is going to consist of doing the pre-bid meeting, responding to questions from bidders during the during the bidding period, preparing addenda as necessary, issuing letters of summary and bids received, conduct a pre-award meeting with the city, conduct pre-construction meetings, things all considered that we have to do with construction administration. So it's, you know, closing out the project, going over change orders, going over submittals, all those type of things that we would need to have them hire them to do for this project. So with that, we asked them for a proposal. Their proposal to do this work for all the bidding. And in addition, what we wanted to do is also, because of the complexity of some of this, during the course of what we were just mentioning with the transformers and all those things, that we feel we're going to need to have some inspection done during that project. So they did provide some money for inspection. If you look on the last page, we have a breakdown of their services there for resident project representation. We have about 240 hours of site visits by the resident representative at $37,154. We have 60 hours for site visits by the project engineer of $22,526, and project management and administration of $2,151. For a total of $61,831. Now, this is just put if we need it. So obviously, we have those hours put in there as a safeguard. If we decide we don't need that, then we wouldn't use those funds for that. But we feel, due to the complexity of some of these areas, that we will need to have someone that knows the engineering aspect of inspection when they're ready to pour these specific areas. As always, we will have our Clint Krendick and myself to be watching this contract, as we always do, just to make sure that we're getting our money's worth.
Any questions? Okay. I'll entertain a motion then.
Okay, we'll make a motion to have legislation approving the proposal of Burgess and Nyepel to provide bidding and construction services for the water reclamation facility concrete repair project in the amount of $138,100. Again, under emergency?
Yes.
Under emergency.
Second.
Okay, I have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Schimmitz?
Yes.
Okay, thank you, Paul.
Thank you.
And again, thank you, gentlemen. Okay, moving on then, we'll go back then to item number one, storm response status update. Hello.
How's everybody today?
Well, how are you?
Good, good.
Happy New Year.
Happy New Year to you guys, too. I get this as far as 11/20 through 12/19. Our rain amount here was 2.24 inches. All of our flood control areas were looked at this month. Our excavation crew did some work on a catch basin on Bainbridge Road, rebuilt the inside and sealed it as well. On Northwoods Lane, there's an area to the east of Northwoods Lane. It has a 2x2 in the ditch, which has always been full. There's a lot, very, very wet area. We were able to remove the water from there, find out where the outfall is. It's basically actually a culvert that goes under the apron of Northwoods Lane. We ditched that out, so now everything's flowing as it should at this point. Where are we here? Our storm basin crew. We clean catch basins in Fox Run, Independence Court, O'Neill's Landing, Timber Lane, and Ledge Hill. Our TV crew, they are following up behind our catch basin crew just to check the mains out. They're currently working in, they just finished up Fox Run and are currently working in O'Neill's Landing. There's also a section of Solon Road in Bainbridge. We're working with Cleveland Water. We just found out exactly, have it isolated where the water break is, and they were out today. So if you guys travel down Bainbridge Road, down by the bowling alley, you might see those guys out there chopping the road up. We had 9 sewer calls, and none of them which were the city's issue, and only one of them were led to an excavation, which was now repaired. So all in all, pretty good month.
Good. Any questions?
Any questions for anybody?
Thanks, Dennis.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Okay, moving on then to item number 2, the City of Solon 2020 Infrastructure Improvement Report.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Happy New Year to the committee.
Making up for me.
Happy New Year.
Yes. Showed up, it went from yours to mine. Okay, item number 2, the monthly construction cost update. Obviously, this is the first month of the year, so obviously there's nothing to report to the committee. Just kind of take this as an opportunity to go over the format. We have all of the projects that were approved by the committee and the finance committee and council in the estimated cost items or column. And then as we bid out and the committee and council award projects, we'll list those in the second column, awarded amounts. And then as we pay estimates through the construction, those numbers will be accounted for in the to-date cost. And then if there are any change orders throughout the course of any of these projects, those will be recognized in the projected cost if they are higher than the actual awarded amounts. One thing I will point out to the committee is if you go all the way down to the bottom under the estimated cost, where it says a balance of infrastructure fund post priority 3 projects, you'll see that number's in parentheses. Means that it would be based on our estimates, that would be a negative in the account. So I don't anticipate us getting there, but based on our estimates and based on the information that we did get from the finance committee or finance department, which is up here at the top, which is current, we would be in a negative in the account. But like I said, I don't anticipate that happening, but just wanted to point that out to the committee. If you have any questions, I can address
most of these
those.
Projects, I mean, I know obviously every year certain ones carry over.
Mm-hmm.
Say like the Briar Hill Drive. I mean, is that looking like that's going to happen this
yes.
year?
Yes, yes. Okay. One project that I will advise the committee on, and I could save it for my status update later, but since the last meeting, we did get some information from Dominion East Ohio Gas. As you may recall, they did a betterment project a few years ago down Solon Road. They had intended at that time to do a phase 2, which was going to be from roughly where they ended in front of the police station going east on Solon Road and incorporating down Bainbridge Road from Solon Road towards Somme. It looks like they are going to want to move forward with that project, which would time-wise would conflict with our plans to do Solon Road, but obviously I would prefer that they do their work before we do ours. So we're having a meeting with them in the next week or so. We're getting that scheduled right now just to kind of go over their time frames and stuff to see if it's even possible for us both to do work there, not at the same time, but in this construction season. But I would anticipate at this time probably that project might get pushed back 1 year just because of their proposed work.
Okay.
And I'll keep the committee posted once
you.
We have some more information.
Okay, great. Any questions for anybody else? Okay, thanks, John. Okay, moving on to item number 3, the 2019 Annual Sewer Grouting Program Contract 2019.11 final closeout.
This is the final change order closeout for the 2019 annual sewer grouting program. The original contract amount was $246,883. There were no change orders for this project, and not all the quantities were used. And we're requesting that legislation be prepared approving this final change order for the 2019 annual sewer grouting program in the amount of $223,117.96. The final cost and quantity and contract evaluations are attached for the committee's consideration.
Any questions from anybody? Okay, I'll entertain a motion.
I'd like to make a motion to prepare legislation approving the final change order of the 2019 annual sewer grouting program contract 2019.11, which will reduce the contract by $23,765.04 and close the contract out in the amount of $223,117.96 to Lake County Sewer Company Incorporated.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Mr. Katsura?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Schimmitz?
Yes.
Okay, moving on to item number four, the 2019 annual catch basin program, contract 2019.04, final closeout.
Yes, this is the final closeout for the 2019 annual catch basin repair program. The original contract value was $161,500. Not all of the contract value was used. And a breakdown of the contract, final costs and quantities, as well as contractor evaluation, are attached for the committee's consideration. The one thing I would note, as I have it documented in my memo, we did ask the contractor to come back and do a second list of basins in the fall, and as a result, we're asking for the completion date to be extended to November 25th, 2019. And I would also add that the contractor did complete the original contract list of catch basins before the completion date.
Good. Any questions from anybody? I'll entertain a motion then.
All right, we'll make a motion to have legislation prepared approving the final change order for the 2019 annual catch basin repair program with TC Construction to close out the contract in the amount of $135,528.96 and to extend the final completion date to November 25th, 2019.
Second.
Okay, I have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Mr. Katsura?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Schimmitz?
Yes.
Okay, moving on to item five, the 2019 annual street striping program, contract 2019.05, final closeout.
Yes, this is the final closeout for the 2019 annual street striping program. The original contract value was $202,075. Not all of the quantities for the project were used. A breakdown of the final quantities and the contractor evaluation are attached for the committee's consideration. And we are asking that the final completion date be modified, I think it is by like 4 days. Yeah, to November 4th. The weather at the time to put down the fall finish up the fall application was a little wet, so we had extended a few days.
Any questions from anyone? Okay. I'll entertain a motion.
I'd like to make a motion to prepare legislation approving the final change order to the 2019 annual street striping program contract 2019.05, which will reduce the contract by $32,523.44, extend the contract completion date by 4 days, and close the contract out in the amount of $169,551.56 to Duramark Incorporated.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Mr. Katsura?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Schimmitz?
Yes.
Okay, thank then you. We'll move on to item eight, purchase of a 2020 Ford F-250 4x4 regular cab pickup truck. Mr. Shimsky, how are you?
Good evening. Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.
New Year.
Start off with the first one, and that is the service department is seeking to purchase and to replace unit 117 with a new 2020 Ford F-250 4x4. The vehicle will be purchased on the Ohio Department of Procurement through the Ford Motor Company Government Index, and the awarded vendor is the Valley Ford Truck Company out of Cleveland, Ohio, for a sum of $35,688.52.
What's this truck going to be used for?
I'm sorry, ma'am.
What's the truck going to be used for? Just for in-service?
Yes, in-service department, yeah.
Any questions, Mark?
Mike, I just have a quick question.
Yes, sir.
Do you check around other locations and other purchasing co-ops that we
Sourcewell,
are able to
Sourcewell, so which was the old NGA, PA, U.S. Communities. Yes.
And this was the lowest. So
yes, sir.
You did look at others.
Yes,
was,
sir.
Okay.
Always do.
Thank you.
Yes, you're welcome.
Any questions? Okay, I'll entertain a motion.
All right, I'll make a motion approving the purchase of a new 2020 Ford F-250 4x4 regular cab pickup truck and to the awarded vendor, Valley Ford Truck, in the amount of $35,688.52.
Second.
Okay, I have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Schimmitz?
Yes.
Okay, moving on to item 9, purchase of a Western MVP-plus V-plow accessories.
Yes, ma'am. These accessories will be placed on the previous memo here on the new Ford pickup, and it's a Western V-plow, which we currently have on all of our new trucks. It will be also a rear window protector, LED lighting, and replacement snow blades for that. It'll be purchased through the Ohio procurement contract through the Concord Road Equipment Company out of Painesville, Ohio, for the total of $9,701.68.
Any questions for anyone? Okay, I'll entertain a motion.
I'd like to make a motion to prepare legislation authorizing the
Hang on. Sorry, Bill's waving.
Yeah, we don't need legislation for this.
I was just
going
to say,
because
you
it's under
really
the 25,000.
You're right, because it's under 10 grand.
So this is more of an informational memo to let the committee know
right,
what kind
right,
of an
gotcha.
Outfit that we're
you're
putting
right.
on that truck.
You're right. Thank you for right, keeping yeah. us appraised of that. Okay, then moving on to item number 10, the purchase lease of a front load refuse recycling truck.
The big boy there. Okay. The Solid Waste Department is requesting the purchase lease of a new 2020 Peterbilt 520 dual steer vehicle on the New Way chassis 40 yard front load packer with the Corrado can. I'm going to play a video so you know understand what a Corrado can is.
Right.
Be so kind, Jeff.
The Corrado can. It's easier to use in cul-de-sacs. It's low maintenance. It works efficiently on both right and left-hand drive trucks. It will outpace a fully automated truck. It has enough reach to pick up around parked cars. It's less messy. The driver has a view of illegal contaminated materials. It transports easily when not in operation. It attaches quickly and easily without tools. It's quieter and saves fuel consumption. It's easy to operate. With hundreds of units in operation nationwide, Corrado Can has a proven track record of reliability and performance. Its simple, rugged design will offer years of trouble-free operation for your residential waste requirements.
You like the video.
That's pretty cool.
The purchase lease will be arranged through the Sourcewell Government Cooperative Program through the New Way Company, provided by the Southeastern Equipment Company of Mentor, Ohio, for a total lease cost of $328,136.35.
Okay. Any questions, Mark?
Yeah, the one question I had is, yes, at the end of the lease, what happens?
We own it free and clear. I believe this is the thing Mr. Rubino's going to do.
Yes, typically we own, at the end of the day, the lease is more like a like a purchase, so we're paying the full price of the truck. But the whole intent of leasing these vehicles is the same intent with the sewer trucks. After 7 years, the repair costs get extremely high, as we're experiencing with our current curb tender trucks. So in discussions with finance and Mr. Rubino, we just wanted to keep on turning these rubbish trucks over to, in order, the upfront costs a little bit more, but down the road the maintenance costs will drop, and the city will in turn see a savings in that.
No, I understand that. I was just, we didn't have any of the, and I recognize we're not the finance committee, but we didn't have any of the details in the memo with respect to you know, how long it was for or anything. At least
I believe the leases are five or 6 years, I think. It's a five-year lease.
Five-year lease, yep.
And I believe Mr. Rubino,
okay.
Mr. Rubino has to bring that towards the finance committee to renegotiate the existing lease with U.S. Bank. It'll be similar with the new Gapvax trucks.
Okay. Any other questions? Okay.
It's mine or yours?
It's yours.
Oh, it's mine.
You gotta go on the other.
I'd like to make a motion to prepare legislation approving the purchase lease of a new 2020 Peterbilt 520 dual steer chassis with a New Way 40-yard front load packer with a Corrado can, automated carry can. This purchase lease will be arranged under the Sourcewell Government Cooperative Program on contract number 112014-NWY through the Southeastern Equipment Company, located at 8757 Tyler Boulevard, Mentor, Ohio, 44060, in the amount of $328,136.35.
Second.
Okay, I have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Mr. Keturah?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Shimmets?
Yes.
Okay, moving on then to item 11, purchase lease of a 2021 International HV 507 6x4 chassis gap vac combination jet vacuum machine.
That's a lot of words.
That's a lot of words.
The sewer department is seeking the lease purchase of a 2021 International HV 6x4 Gapvax combination vacuum machine to replace our current one that will be expiring its lease in June of 2020. The new unit will be leased for 5 years. I'm sorry, I forgot that. Term ranged through the finance department and is being purchased on the Ohio Procurement STS contract through the MTEC company of Cleveland, Ohio, for the sum of $426,799. We also purchased the extended warranties for the chassis and the engine and transmission.
Okay. Any questions?
No, okay. That's 5 years on.
Okay, I'll entertain a motion then.
All right, well, make a motion to approve the purchase of the 2021 International HV 507 6x4 chassis Gapvax combination jet vacuum machine. Unit will be leased for 5 years. Per our arrangements of the finance department, the vehicle will be purchased through the Ohio Procurement STS contract through MTEC Company, Cleveland, Ohio, in the amount of $426,799.
Yes, sir.
Second.
Okay, have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Mr. Keturah?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Shimmets?
Yes.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay, moving on. Correspondence, we have none. Other, we have none. Projects and reports. We'll move on then to the Engineering Department study design report. John?
Good evening. Just a few things I want to point out to the committee, as always, is the summary of permits at the top of the report. This is kind of a year-end total to which we had 2,028 permits submitted through the city for the year of 2019. A couple other items just want to point out to the committee. In addition to what we discussed earlier regarding Solon Road, our Aurora Road Phase 1 project, based on discussions with ODOT, is most likely going to get moved back 1 year to 2022 due to the time frame that it's needed for all of the utility companies, such as the Illuminating Company, Ameritech, so on and so forth, to have all their utilities moved in preparation for the project. Based on the schedule that we were looking at, everybody agreed that it was going to be impossible to have everything moved and ready. If there's any other questions from the committee, I can address those now.
Any other questions from anybody? Thanks, John. Okay, moving on then to the Construction Department report. Hi, Dan.
Hello, Happy Mr. New Chairman. Year. I'll take you right to page 3, where we'll take a look at the emergency road repairs. That's during the month of, actually it was the end of November, but too late to hit the December report. We performed 3 repairs, and they were all due to water breaks, although that one says it was emergency road repair. Lakeview was a water break repair. In the amount of $5,618.61. Our beginning balance was $170,518. We still have $164,899 to hold us till February 29th, when this project will be complete. And then on the last page of my report, I have the supplemental inspection services, and we had at the balance at the end of September was $426,828. October, we spent $96,144. In November, our estimated amount is $63,277. We presently have a balance of $267,406. That project goes until the end of May. And the Som Aurora people will probably be continuing to be busy throughout the winter. A lot of paperwork, and a lot of the contractors still buttoning some things up, and then traffic signals will come in and that sort of thing. So
I mean,
if there's any other questions?
Yeah, Som and Aurora, I mean, basically it's except for just
yeah, I have a sheet here, I believe, on the Som and Aurora. If we turn back to page 7, and basically they're buttoning up a lot of odds and ends right now, but they're waiting for the posts to come in for the ground-mounted signs for the traffic signals. They'll have topsoil and seeding in the spring, and I think crosswalks aren't done on the pavement striping, but pretty much most of the important pavement striping is done.
Okay, so we're getting there. It's a huge project.
Yes,
and
there is a large portion of concrete that's going to get done at the south end of the project, south of the intersection in the northbound direction.
Okay. Great. Okay, any questions from anyone? Okay, thanks, Dan. Okay, moving on then to the 2019 Annual Sanitary and Storm System Repair Program Update. Dennis?
This report's basically going to mirror last month's report. We started off at $450,000. We are currently have $156,271.62 left. Tracks did start mobilizing in the Rolling Brook area. They will start doing some ditching, I believe. Opening day should be Wednesday for that. So as of right now, their estimated amount for that project is $23,297.47. So we'll see what happens here when they're all wrapped up.
Well, the weather's been a little more cooperative than sometimes what we're used to at this time of year. So, okay, any questions from anyone?
One more thing we have coming up is there's another issue at the plant coming on, so tomorrow we'll figure out what that's also going to be. Okay. So there'll be a rough estimate added to that list too.
Okay, and this contract goes through March.
Through March, yes.
Okay, thank you. Okay, then we move on to the Water Reclamation Department report, Paul.
The only thing I'd like to add at this time is Dennis just mentioned, you never know what the day brings. We came in this morning. I walked the plant, walked through the solids building, everything's fine, went back to my office. About 10 minutes later, they called me and said, we bursted a water line in the solids building. I said, are you kidding me? I mean, the water, on our plant effluent line, right in the vicinity where we had the repair done in that solids bay a couple years ago, we had another water line break. So it was an 8-inch plant effluent line that busted in there. It heaved in mud everywhere, and it was pretty incredible. So at least we got it shut off and isolated. We're still able to operate the plant, and as Dennis mentioned, we're having someone come down tomorrow just to look at performing the repairs. So I can't stress enough how important it is to have that contract for things of this nature when they pop up.
Sure. Okay. Okay, then any questions on the water reclamation report from anyone? You guys okay with it? Okay, so then we'll move on to the service department report. Hi, Tom.
Hello. Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.
Well, the service department looked like they were extremely busy while I was away from the office. They got a lot of work done. I was reviewing numbers last week. And the fall leaf collection program ended with about 14,000 yards of leaves collected. I think they did an excellent job, made around 8 trips throughout the city. We had minimal damage to the equipment. Usually we have some, heavy damage to some of those pieces of equipment from sucking up bricks or rocks. We were able to run a new piece of equipment this year. We have a one-man leaf loader that goes on a hook lift that the committee approved and council approved last year. So it was really nice to be able to see. They showed it to me on videos at home. I wasn't able to be here to see it, but they were running that machine. So it's operated from inside the cab of the truck, and then they usually just put one raker with it. So we have another one of those coming in 2020, so it'll be nice to see both of those in use in the fall of 2020. It looked like there was about 11 snow events so far since October. We used about 1,600 tons of salt during these events, which equated to about 145 tons per event. So when I ran the mileage and the numbers, we're putting down about 150 pounds per lane mile during these events, depending upon what the managers instruct the crews to do. But from all the dispatch reports I've seen and the snow reports, they did an excellent job using minimal salt, trying to keep what we have in stock. That's really all I have to add. There was a lot in the report. The administrative division, being Mark Holly and the rest of the service department managers, were very busy getting end of the year evaluations done and just ordinary administrative stuff in the office. So I appreciate them and Mr. Dursek running things while I was out. Very proud of the department for how well they operate, so they don't miss a beat.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Great. Any questions from anyone? Okay. Again, great job, everyone.
All right.
And I will then entertain a motion to adjourn.
I will make a motion to adjourn.
Second.
Motion, second. Motion, please.
Mr. Couture?
Yes.
Mrs. Beeney?
Yes.
Mr. Schimmel?
Yes.
Tomorrow.
So did you know who that was?
I
did. You know who
that was? Yeah.
Because his funeral is supposed to be tomorrow. I think the wake was tonight. The computer was tomorrow.
They postponed it.
Yeah, it's not that they're together. That was like.
I just can't imagine.